Hello and welcome. We are here in a continuation of our conversation with Dr. Richard Jefferson. Tell us something about how you came to open source biology.
What ended up happening is that the public sector started selling off their rights to large players and to small players, which were then absorbed by the larger players. So it began to be this consolidation of capabilities, and probably several thousand patents emerged worldwide around not only this trick of transferring the gene, but how you did it in this particular crop or at this particular stage of development and so on and so forth. So you had this thicket, as we call it, of patents that were incredibly difficult to understand, written in ecclesiastical language, interpretable only by an expensive clergy. So we set out to understand that. So we hired some expensive clergy, wonderful patent attorneys who would help guide this into a public resource. And we published that online as an open resource to look at this transfer of agrobacterium of genes into plants. And we discovered something wonderful. When you actually look at the evidence and actually look at it in its context, almost like a map, a cartography of this innovation, we could actually see that there were plenty of spaces between these apparent shoals and reefs of intellectual property that people hadn't drawn attention to. And there was one in particular. Instead of wending your way through it, why not do an end run around it? It's the classic sports metaphor, if there's anybody caring about that. Do you pound through the line or do you run around it? Well, in this particular case, it turned out that, as you know, law depends on definitions and precedent. And if the early definitions are thought to be adequate, those definitions are held to throughout the whole history of that particular innovation. Well, that's true. They all said it was Agrobacterium tumefaciens, this one particular species of bacteria that was capable of doing gene transfer. And everybody used the same terminology on. And we thought, well, what if there's another species out there? What if there's a benign species that's not a plant pathogen that causes tumors, but a gentle bacterium, a sweet bacterium? And what if we ask that bacterium through laboratory intervention to do the same thing, to be the charon, to take the genes in, but don't mess with the plant otherwise? And it would fall completely outside the definition of all these patents. And patents are extremely defined by their definitions. And it turned out that we conceived that let's find a benign bacterium, rhizobium, which is another natural soil bacterium, but doesn't cause disease, causes a very beneficial effect in plants. And can we get that to do the same thing? And then work around 1,000 patents, which are constrained by using that definition. So that was our scientific idea that was informed by patent transparency. So then we set out to do it, a tiny team of us funded by bake sales and car washes, and we did it. And we published it as a cover article in Nature, the journal, not the phenomenon, and we decided to share it with everyone. So we patented it. And this is in a sense, the counterintuitive moment. We're thinking, how do we ensure that the same thing doesn't happen again? If we just send it out there, what happens in all the improvements that actually make it commercially viable? Remember that first stage of an invention is never really a finished stage. It's always a good lead. And from there, people improve it. And to make something commercially viable, it has to be able to produce, you know, 1,000 events per week or whatever. And if you need to adapt it for your crop, people will make improvements. And those improvements are important to be able to make it a usable invention. And we knew that. So the question is, if we just put it out in the public domain, first of all, it would save us a lot of money. And we'd be able to still get some press about how wonderful it was. But would it actually have the impact we want of busting a monopoly? Because a new monopoly can form very quickly by obscuring even what we our best intentions led us to think was a good course. So we patented it. And we spent a couple of years while we knew this was going to work. Our science, I knew it was going to work in my heart. So I spent a lot of time with our patent professionals going around to every university, every legal scholar, every company, and said, what sort of license could you live with? How could we build a license around a patent that actually could forestall the development of a monopoly like this? And we listened to a lot of people, and that's an important part of this. Scientists are not very good at listening to people outside their realm of expertise, and we really had to stretch ourselves to learn how to do it, make an interdisciplinary team. So we did that, and by the time we published that, we had filed patents, and then prepared a new type of license we called the BIOS license. And this is what became quickly biological open source, but using patents instead of copyright. So we started providing this under a license that said, you may use it at no cost to you, but we ask you to behave in a different way. We ask that if you improve this technology, you don't assert those rights over anyone else who's agreed to the same terms. So it was the opening up of the open source concept of biology. And it kind of worked. That was 5 years ago. We got good write-ups in The Economist, The New York Times, and other fairly substantial journals. We had a very nice write-up here, a very thoughtful one in Business World India trying to promote this approach. But what happened is that it became clear over the next 5 years that the challenges we were facing were not going to be overcome by piecemeal, one-at-a-time solutions with patents. There are millions of patents out there, and the idea that each one is going to be picked apart is unreasonable. We need to look for a structural solution that comes that goes well beyond a single patent and an add-back of grants. So even though we got many licensees of our technology, we didn't see the successful change in innovation culture we wanted. I actually thought the public sector would be my strongest ally, and I'd have to really wrestle with the private sector. Ironically, it's been exactly the opposite way. The public sector has perverse incentives. They don't have any positive incentive for social delivery of their work product. So most academics are rewarded for publishing and for beating someone else in the publishing process, for getting grants and for getting a committee and getting a parking place, but basically not for social adoption of their work product. The private sector, ironically, can only exist if they do get social adoption. They're called customers. And if they don't get adoption, they go out of business. We were trying to convince a public sector that's willy-nilly using everybody's intellectual property every day. I mean, every laboratory in Delhi, every laboratory in Brisbane, every laboratory in Berkeley is using intellectual property, patented technology, every day with no consequence to themselves. They just use it all the time. They, in a sense, contaminate their work product by using other people's technology impermissibly without their permission. But nobody's going to come after them, and they're okay, because they can get their paper out in Cell or Science or Nature or second-tier journals, and they can advance their careers. The problem is, it makes the contribution very hard to assemble into a final innovation affordably that can benefit people who need it the most. It basically puts carbuncles on every piece of science. And we realized then that trying one at a time to prize off carbuncles was not a way to change social policy and innovation policy. We were getting buy-in from the companies because they saw that they were spending ridiculous amounts of money at accessing pre-competitive platforms, the very question you asked. So the companies, yeah, we could live with that. It's not our usual way of doing business, but we could save a lot of money and actually open up our reinvestments in real products and services. Well, that's okay. So it ended up that I'd gone into it thinking that I was going to really dislike the private sector and find the public sector was adopting our worldview. Public sector just didn't care because they don't have any reward system. So the private sector cared, but not enough, because by the time we got there, it was too little, too late. There was always already a stovepiping of the industry. So, coming around to your whole GMO question and what's happening right now, the problem is that we've allowed the lexicon to be rewritten, where science has been captured by big industry or by behavior sets that look a lot like big industry. It's not that big industry is necessarily bad, but it should never be the only game in town. And the problem is we've allowed it to be. So the biggest problem with Monsanto is not Monsanto, it's us in the public sector. We have allowed a scorched earth to occur. We've allowed a dysfunctional ecology of innovation to happen where the science has been, in a sense, owned by big companies, and frankly, not even to their service. To be honest, most big companies would probably be able to do a fine job when there's a flourishing of different and alternative business models. But when you ask the question about exclusive licensing, if exclusive licensing is an option, most people will say that it's an essential one. If you tell a drug company that one of the options we can negotiate for is exclusive, do you think they're going to say, no, we won't have that, we'll go for something else? If, on the other hand, you offer it and you say, we only do it non-exclusively, they'll turn their back? Yeah, but only as part of a bargaining tool. Generally, people will take non-exclusive because they just want to get the job done. So, our approach generally is to say that with GMOs, the problem with them isn't the genetic modification, because in fact all the crops that we grow here in India or anywhere in the world are de facto genetically modified through the artifice of human invention. We wouldn't have modern wheats without slamming together three genomes that had never seen each other historically. It was genetic modification through human intervention. Now, what's the difference? The difference is we've allowed that human intervention to sound inhuman, to not have a personal component. To be honest, the genetics of modern crops is a very complex and beautiful thing, but the genetics of modern ecosystems is more exciting, and that local scale knowledge could contribute so much if science was their tool. And we haven't allowed that to happen. So we need is to rethink the debate. It's not about GMOs. It's not about genetic modification. It's about really how democratized the scientific process can be. Because in fact, some of the interventions that GMOs are doing are okay. In the industrial agriculture paradigm where they were invented, they're actually better than what came before. There's no doubt in my mind that the data about, let's say, Roundup Ready soybean actually supports the contention that we've saved a lot of diesel in industrial agriculture by not having to do multiple tilling. We've saved a lot of very toxic herbicide sprays that are more toxic than Roundup. But the problem is that it reinforced a superficially successful paradigm of industrial agriculture. It allowed that to have more life. You breathe some life into it for some years. it wasn't bad in the context of what it was doing. Compared to what came immediately before in the same context, it was an improvement. There's no doubt about it. So these guys are not liars, I think, about the impact on industrial agriculture. What's happened, unfortunately, is that short-term success breeds a particular lemming-like convergence to that way of solving problems. So it's not that Monsanto is bad. It's that we don't have a viable, science-driven alternative ecology. And we need one. We need to have a lot of different creative ideas about how you'd use science to adjust ecosystem development. So we're throwing a baby out with the bathwater. By raging against the GMO, what we're actually doing is throwing out the beauty of complex mechanism-driven science to understand how things work. So it's either total empiricism or big multinationals. There is stuff in between, but it's not a linear in between. It's not black, white, and gray. It's black, white, and B flat minor. It's a different metric. And that's what we should depend on. That's what we should demand in society.